everybody. I'm Patricia Duff, and I'm really happy to welcome our many call-in audience members and our extraordinary guest speakers to The Common Good. As we all know, this pandemic has caused enormous loss of life and social and business disruption and deep economic pain, even as we start to reopen the country. But we hope that through these conversations, we can still maintain our sense of community and our sense of purpose and stay informed. And that's what we try to do with The Common Good. It's our mission to help make our democracy stronger through our programs and initiatives. Most importantly, we encourage the active participation of all citizens in our national policy dialogue because we are in this together now. More than ever, we need to do our part. And doing our part, we have two extraordinary individuals, Sir Ronald Cohen and our own Alan Patricof, a great dear friend, honorary board member, and who's helped us with so many of these events. But our special guest is a pioneering philanthropist, a venture capitalist, a private equity investor, and social innovator who's driving what he calls the global impact revolution to achieve real social and environmental change. His leadership is extraordinary. He serves as the chairman of the Global Steering Group for Impact Investment in the Portland Trust. He is co-founder of Social Finance UK, USA, and Israel. He chaired the G8 Social Impact Investment Task Force, and he's held many other prestigious and important international and national roles. He's dynamic and innovative, and he's got a book coming out in July about our topic called Impact, Reshaping Capitalism to Drive Real Change. So I hope this is the beginning of getting that book. He lives in the UK and Israel, and he's coming to us all the way from Israel. So thank you so much for taking the time to be with us today, Ronnie. And now I'm handing it over to you, Alan. It's all yours.
Okay. First and foremost, I want to show you Ronald's new book. I hope you're seeing it spelled from left to right rather than right to left. Yes. I thought it was a great cover. The title of the cover is the title of this conversation today, which is Impact. For those of you who don't know, and I see so many familiar faces, I'm sure a lot of you do know, Ronald and I were partners for, I guess we say 30 years, going back to 1970s, and we built a business together called Apex Partners. And in the early 2000s, Ronald and I both decided, each on our own, to move in different directions. And I moved back into the venture business from what had become the private equity business at that point. And Ronald took a different tack and has, in the last 20 years, built an enormous worldwide reputation. Now, you all may not know of it, but in the world of impact investing, social impact investing, Ronald is probably the leading person in the world today. And I say world, meaning, and he'll explain to you, but Ronald has initiated this concept in India, in China, in Japan. There isn't a country in the world. In fact, every time I speak to him, he seems to be in another country, but he's confined to Israel for a moment. And it goes back to a speech Ronald made in 2000. And I thought, Ronald, what I'd start out with is, in your book, in the first introduction, it talks about the curtain of fire speech, which I thought was a great title. I mean, you and Winston Churchill had great speeches with great titles, but it launched you in this whole area of concern about not just making money, but doing good in the world. So maybe you can introduce the subject of impact investing, social impact, and you know, why you got into it and how it's carried you on this mission for now 20 years.
Thank you very much, Alan. And to all of you in this meeting, it's such a great pleasure to be with you and exchanging ideas with my dear friend and partner, Alan. And Patricia, thank you for hosting us. The Common Good does great work. And I hope that you'll all participate in this discussion, because it touches on really some very fundamental points about our lives and the kind of world we want to live in. And Alan referred to a speech I made on the 30th anniversary of APEX, in which I said that if we didn't deal differently with those whom society leaves behind, then a curtain of fire would rise to separate rich from poor. And unfortunately, this prediction from 2002 has turned out to be true. And we have seen, whether it's the Gilets Jaunes or in Chile or in the Lebanon or many other countries, protests about the inequality which our system creates and has created in the past. And for all the good that our capitalist system has done, the sole focus on profit with a disregard for the consequences, the impact that we have on people and on the environment has really led to a self-defeating system where companies backed by investors create a lot of negative consequences which governments then tax us to try to remedy. And the inequalities that exist today can't really be remedied by government just redistributing income and wealth. Even those who are in favor of going to extremes in, you know, in doing that, recognize that it won't be enough. So Alan, I sort of hand the question back to you by just explaining that we have to do more than tinker in order to meet the huge social and economic challenges we face. And I believe that we have to shift from a paradigm of risk and return to a paradigm of risk, return, and impact. And you know, I'm very, very happy to have a discussion with you about
that. Well,
let's
talk about what you mean by impact. I mean, is this a new form of capitalism? I know you say in your book that this is a smart business decision. We hear a lot about CSR in this country, and everybody's talking about corporate social responsibility. I think this takes CSR to a next step, and maybe get into more exactly how it works.
Right. So maybe it's useful just to describe impact investment first, which is where I started. I started off in 2000, really, when Alan and I were both at APEX. And by the way, Alan, I mean, you and I go back 45 years now. We were lucky to be alive when venture capital started. We smelled that something was different in the air. And I feel exactly the same way today about impact investment. So I mean, I think because we have that perspective, and many in, you know, on this call have it also, there are big parallels that we can draw between the tech revolution, say, and the impact revolution. But impact investment is investment that seeks to achieve not just profit, but measurable improvement in lives and in the planet. Okay? And we've always assumed that when we invest, we have to make the maximum amount of profit. And the same assumption continues if we're trying to optimize to balance risk, return, and impact. You may be able to make more money by serving people who are underserved, because there are hugely greater numbers of them, than you make by just serving the middle class or high net worth individuals. And so the concept that you can do good and do well at the same time is being proved today by entrepreneurs all over the world. You could take Elon Musk as an example. Elon Musk's purpose in leading Tesla was not just to make money. It was to make money and to wean our world away from combustion engine cars and the pollution that they bring. So I started off on this road by trying to invent new ways of bringing investment capital to non-profits, basically. And we invented some new securities like called the social impact bonds, where the return an investor achieves depends on a social improvement.
Can you give an example, Ronald, for example, in the, I guess it was back in the early days, and it's probably still happening, how a social impact financing relates to a prison reform. Let's use that as an sure. example.
Sure. So the first social impact bond that Alan's referring to was launched in 2010. And basically, we went to the British government and we said, you have a problem with prisoners going back to jail. We'll raise £5 million. We'll fund not-for-profits that are trying to help these prisoners get into jobs instead of going back to jail. And you'll pay us the capital back with a return according to the number of prisoners that we actually help get into jobs and stay out of jail. So the nonprofits that we backed for the first time got investment capital rather than donations. And we reduced the number of kids, because it focused on young men, going back to jail by nearly 10%, and the investors got their money back, paid by the government, and got 3.1% a year. So that was the first time we had a security where the return depended on achieving a social improvement. Today, there are a couple of hundred social and development impact bonds across the world.
Well, let's not go lightly on that, Ron. That's pretty significant. What's the size, would you say, today of social impact investing? I mean, starting from zero in 2000, I mean, how big is the concept today and how many countries?
So today, I would say that impact investment today, where you measure the impact you create as well as the profit, is about a $1 trillion market across the world.
So it consists of governments who put up money and matched by nonprofits or foundations or philanthropies or family groups or whatever, who are willing to take a lower rate of return in order to and produce results. And as a result, the government will give them a greater return than a basic return they would have made, but not the kind of return that you and I wanted to get in the venture capital business. So people have to have an altruistic motive as part of this.
So first of all, the trillion includes social and development impact bonds, Alan, but social and development impact bonds are a small part of impact investment, which includes debt to not-for-profit organizations, impact private equity, impact venture capital, impact infrastructure, impact real estate, and so on. But you're right. Today, there's probably $500 billion invested and commitments to pay over $1 billion for results achieved.
You say in your book that you believe that this is, and I'm quoting you, it will reshape the capitalist system. That's a pretty big statement. I mean, you really feel that it can go that far to reshape the capitalist system?
Yeah, what do I mean by that? I mean that if we want to turn our economies to deliver solutions instead of a lot of problems as well as some solutions, then decision making within our economies has to be on the basis of risk, return, and impact. And we used to think we couldn't measure risk. And in the middle of the last century, we began to measure risk, and the idea of risk-adjusted returns opened the door to venture capital and private equity, where many of us on this call have led their careers. And in a similar way, when we begin to measure impact, I think we will change the nature of our economies. Risk thinking brought diversification and brought investment in emerging markets and venture capital and the tech revolution. Impact thinking is going to bring us a series of entrepreneurs who want to create unicorns, which, if they're impact unicorns, won't just have a value of a billion, that touch the lives or improve the lives of a billion people as well. And so I believe that if, for instance, today our governments decided that every company has to publish, in addition to its normal financial accounts, accounts that are weighted for the impact which their product and their operations and their employment creates on people and the environment, and if you added the positive impact to their bottom line and deducted the negative impact, it would change the behavior of companies. And investors today, Alan, as you well know, are investing more than $30 trillion, 15% of all investable assets in the world, 30% of all professionally managed assets, in what's known as ESG, environmental, social, and governance investing. So if you begin to bring measurement to companies, these investors are going to make choices that make a huge difference to us. I'll give you an example. If you look at just the operations of the oil companies, take three, they have hugely differing impact on the environment. So if you look at Exxon, as I show in the book, the annual damage from the operations, not from the use of the oil subsequently in transportation and so on, is $40 billion a year. You compare it with Shell. Shell's damage is $12 billion a year. Compare it with BP, it's $8 billion a year. Now, if you're an investor and you still want to invest in fossil fuels, but your conscience tells you, I really don't want to create even greater environmental problems, who are you going to invest in? And if you shift your investment from Exxon to BP or Shell, what does it do for the value of Exxon? And what does it do for the value of BP or Shell? So if you bring impact to the center of our economic system, because companies and investors are actually investing according to it, you do change capitalism.
We have a few people here from abroad, but most people are from the US. What are some examples of who have you gotten on board? The Rockefeller Foundation, the Ford Foundation, Citibank, JP Morgan. Who's buying into your thesis? Well,
of course, a lot of philanthropists, all of those you've mentioned, and the MacArthur Foundation and the Hewlett Foundation, many, many foundations. And
they put their money in as well as their support and intellectually?
Yeah, so it's changing thinking. The Ford Foundation allocated from its endowment $1 billion to impact investment. Why? Because you can deliver risk, return, and impact in an attractive way, meaning you can get an uncorrelated return at very attractive levels. The level of return on social impact bonds we were talking about in the UK on a portfolio of 40 or 50 social impact bonds is about 8% gross, should be about 6% net.
That's pretty good.
For an uncorrelated asset, which doesn't go up and down with the stock market or interest rates even, that is a very attractive return. So now you're beginning to see foundations using their balance sheet to achieve social aims. But the most famous example is BlackRock, Larry Fink, who came out in his famous letter a couple of years ago, saying those who want to prosper have to deliver social and environmental good as well. Why? Because investors are moving away from them.
You convinced him. That's why.
No, and then the young generation did, Alan, because young people don't want to work for companies that that pollute and profiteer. And investors don't want to invest in them.
You gave the oil example of one oil company polluting less than the other, but isn't the money also in these social impact bonds, for example, used to, I'm asking, but building a school or doing something in the educational system that will end up graduating more people out of high school who go to college or however you quantify it. And that is the form of return that gives the incentive for the government to give incentive. Maybe you can give some of those examples, because when it gets to oil companies doing better, it has a different connotation to it, I think.
Yeah. So, and I'm not in favor of investing in fossil fuels. So let's take the issue of education. We all know that education is a great lever of social progress. If you look at education in Africa, you have about 300 million kids who are out of school or in school and not learning. Now, let's say you want to have a shot at improving the lives of 10 million of these kids. You could say, well, I'm going to throw money at it. I'm going to invest in creating schools and classrooms and so on and so forth.
Which is what our foreign aid program does.
So. Yeah, and people have sort of lost faith that that delivers results. Now compare it with creating what we call an outcomes fund in the book of $1 billion funded by aid organizations like USAID and DFID and so on, and big philanthropies, okay? And that $1 billion is professionally managed by people who signed contracts with those NGOs and purpose-driven businesses in the education field that think they can manage to get results. So you sign a contract, I'll give you from my $1 billion pool a contract for 30 million if you'll have 300,000 kids in northern Ghana, and this is a true example. Now, the delivery organization, the not-for-profit working on, helping these kids stay in school, convincing their parents to keep them in school, improving the standard of teaching, standard of the facilities, turns around to a development impact bond fund and says, look, I think I can deliver this intervention for 20 million. If you'll invest 20 million in me, this outcomes fund will pay 30, and it'll pay 30 if I achieve a certain level. If I, I think I can do, I can get to the 30, but even if I only get lower results and get to the 25, you'll get your money back. But the return you'll make will be between 1 and 10%, depending on how many kids I actually teach.
Okay. But Ronald, isn't a big part of what you're doing making a significant improvement over what the government alone could do? Let's stop there. What government alone could do, it's to improve. Government does allow, I'm not saying I agree with it, but let's say everyone says government does a bad job of educating kids. Government does a bad job of running the prisons. Government does a bad job in all these other areas, but they're doing it. They're pouring money into it. So what your thesis is really impact investing is saying, make it a public-private activity, and the private part will make it better, have better results, reduce the cost to government, and give a share of that to private investors for doing it.
The difference is that it's pay for success. So you're not just saying, if government wants to subcontract some of its activity, and the private sector does it, it'll be done better. You're saying we want to pay for outcomes. Government will only pay when it's been successful. Investors will take the risk of delivery, of actually hitting those numbers. And if you do that, you sort of replicate what we saw in venture capital, where investors take the risk. And government pays when it works, or the philanthropist pays when it works.
So,
Yeah. Sorry, go on, Alan.
I saw Craig raised his hand, but I'm going to turn it over to Patricia, who is the our esteemed leader. Patricia, okay? We can't hear you, Patricia.
We've got a lot of really top business people and some interesting press people like Jillian Tett.
Patricia, can I interrupt? I'm sorry. I forgot to ask one very important question.
Absolutely.
Can you tell everybody, Ronald, how the people on this call, because that's really the most important. There are, 100, 150 people on this line. How can they participate in this impact revolution? I'm sorry, Patricia. I just thought I think that's an important thing to understand why people should listen to this.
Well, they can participate by, of course, buying social impact bonds, which address today 14 different social issues, including homelessness, prevention of diabetes, dropout rates from school, et cetera, et cetera.
How do they buy it? How do they find these? How do they find these bonds?
So there are organizations called like Social Finance, which are issuing these bonds. The biggest one you asked about that is in the US, in South Carolina, $30 million dealing with teenage unmarried mothers. So that is a small amount of money today, because you can put $100,000 or 50 or 10 into a social impact bond. The other thing we're going to start seeing now is the green bonds, which are now a $1 trillion market, moving into social bonds for education, which are just normal bonds. They not pay for success. Blue bonds, which are there to help clean up the ocean. Brown bonds, which are there to make sure that soil preserves its quality, and so on. So you can buy those types of products. Then you have impact venture capital funds, the funds that invested in Tesla, the double bottom line fund on the West Coast, Bridges Ventures.
Which you started.
which I was involved in founding, and others. Now you have private equity firms raising funds. TPG raised a $2 billion or $3 billion fund. I think they've raised $4 billion.
That's the Rises Fund? The Rise Fund?
The Rise Fund. That's the Rise Fund, which Jeff Skoll and Bono and others are involved in. Bain Capital has raised a couple of funds. Carlyle is talking about taking its whole private equity investing to measure impact and become impact investment. Apollo raising a fund. KKR raised an ESG fund. Blackstone.
Okay. I got my answer. Patricia, now I'll shut up.
Yeah. Well, I really want to welcome your questions and maybe pick on a few people, because we've got some terrific business leaders on board here. Perhaps our great friend Bernard Schwartz might ask a question, Byron Wien, Jeff Rosen, Stan Schumann, Sam Waxel. You guys are all giants in your own way, and I'm wondering if you might want to ask a question here.
Craig raised his hand.
Where is Craig?
I don't know. I saw his hand.
Okay, you're unmuted. Go, Craig.
Oh, thanks, Patricia. Thank you, Alan. And Ronald, great to see you again. I just want to kind of reframe this in the context of COVID-19 and the general, I'll call it, theory of transformation and institutional resistances. So you've mentioned, I gotta turn my phone off. We know you mentioned education, healthcare, prisons, et cetera, but in particularly, how can we make best use of the crisis of COVID-19, particularly in healthcare, where you've seen things like telemedicine has been catapulted probably by almost light years? How can we as a group come together to use this moment where I'll call it institutional resistance is probably at an all-time low in certain senses, political resistance, probably at an all-time high. But if you take a look at the various sectors, what can we all do to use this, let no good crisis go to waste?
Right. That's an amazing question, Craig. So let's take the issue of the release of containment, which many countries are now embarking on. It's going to be very difficult for releasing containment to work if we don't have testing. If you don't test people and isolate them when you find they've been infected, it makes it a lot more difficult to stem the spread of the virus, obviously. So the Global Steering Group, the GSG for Impact Investment, which I chair, proposed a $10 billion innovation bond. This innovation bond would go with orders from governments for $10 billion of tests. So it's been done before. Some of you are probably aware of it at the time of Ebola. But let's say that the US government says, I want to buy $10 billion of tests. I'll pay more. I'll pay up to $100 per test, which is what the government has approved for reclaim from insurance, from health insurance. And I'll pay the $100 if it's a quick response, handheld device, disposable, and I'll pay a bit less if it's something else. But I need, I need billions of tests, basically. When you put that order down, you de-risk the sales side for the companies you signed the deal with. Now, assume that some of these companies are in Silicon Valley or Route 128 or in Texas, and they've been backed by venture investors. If they have to raise money, which might be $10 million per production line to deliver 2 million tests a year, and they want to deliver 10 million tests, then they need $50 million. So the government would provide a bond guarantee. And that bond, that $50 million would be guaranteed by the government at the time when it places the order. And the return on it would depend on the number of tests delivered, and it could go from 0% to 10%. Now, what would happen if you did that? What would happen if you did that is you'd get pension fund. If it's in California, it would be CalPERS or CalSTRS coming out and saying, hey, I'll take a billion of that. It's got the government risk. I'm not going to lose my money. I can make up to 10% if I pick my companies carefully, and I help to solve a social problem. So that's just one example, Craig, of how this form of impact thinking leads you in a different direction than normal investing would.
This sounds really exciting. And since you mentioned BlackRock, we have to have Matt Mallow ask a question. Matt?
So it's not so much a question as a comment and really an echo of what Sir Ronald has been saying. And if you look at the first quarter of this year, including into the COVID-19 pandemic, I think you'll see that socially responsible investments, they're not all impact, Sir Ronald, but they are in the ESG world, actually outperformed the conventional indices by a reasonable margin. It's only a quarter, it may not go on. And certainly the flows of funds have been heavily, heavily on the side of ESG investments. And that will, I believe, in accord with what Sir Ronald has just said, lead to impact investing and will change particularly the investing patterns, particularly for the demographic of people 40 years of age and under, and they are the future of investing. It's unfortunately not folks like me. Our day was behind us, not in front of us from this point of view, but the 40-year-olds do care about it. The other reason that this will, in my view and in BlackRock's view, certainly accelerate is because if you look at our 16,000 employees, the average age is in the low 30s, I believe. And they're the one, they as employees want to see us conduct ever increasing amounts of socially responsible investing. So we now have hundreds of billions of dollars of assets under management in this arena, and we're not alone, where there's plenty of competition, and it's going to grow by leaps and bounds, I think, over the course of the next few years, and in large measure, thanks to the pioneering work that Sir Ronald, you did. So I just wanted to add that comment, not so much a question.
Thank you. I actually wanted to ask you if this would be some way that we could attack some of the big issues, like in the United States, we can't seem to get infrastructure funded. Is there a way of doing that through impact investing?
So you could do it. Let's say that you wanted to take the rundown areas of a city, the slums of a city, then you could certainly achieve social impact in doing that. But if you need to build another pike, unless it's in a poor area or connecting a poorer community to job opportunities, the impact would be very diluted in terms of helping the most vulnerable in our society, but it could still be positive impact. The question is, what do you measure? How do you measure the impact? If it creates employment in the area, Patricia, that would certainly qualify as an impact investment. You just have to measure the employment created.
There's a lot of us who'd like to see that happen in the United States, where so much infrastructure hasn't really been done in decades. Or rebuilding the power grid, or any number of putting broadband in rural areas so that every American can go on the internet now that we're schooling from home. Do we have any other questions? Byron, would you like to ask a question? Can I toss it to you? Here, let me unmute him. Oh, he's muted. Uh-oh. There he is. Okay.
Ronald, I'm concerned that what is the trade-off between impact and return? In other words, does there always have to be a positive return from impact investing?
There doesn't always have to be, Byron, but there certainly can be. So what does introducing impact to risk return do in terms of the efficient investment frontier? Okay. I think potentially it moves it upwards, so a higher return for the same level of risk. Why? First of all, as we've heard, there are certain risks associated with companies that are polluting or using practices that don't accord with the values of the young generation. They can see their products decline because consumers desert them. They can see their best employees leave because they don't like the values, and they can see investors desert them, as has happened with investors in coal, in recent years. And if you look at different indices for fossil fuels and new energy and so on, you can see very clearly that the polluters are going down, and those who are helping our climate situation are improving. But at the same time, Byron, I think when you put on an impact lens, you see opportunities you wouldn't have seen. May I give you an example? Here in Israel, where I sit, there's an amazing company called Orcam. And Orcam was set up by the people who sold out to Intel, Mobileye, for $15 billion. So great entrepreneurs. And the aunt of one of the founders was going blind. And she asked the founder to help her. She said, "You're a smart guy. You help me." And 6 years ago, they realized they could use their technology to help the blind. How did they do that? They designed a pair of spectacles which whispers in the ear of the wearer the newspaper article that he or she is holding, the banknote in their hand. And so all of a sudden you begin to say, my God, there are 35 million blind people in the world. There are 250 million visually impaired people. Wow, this is really a proper impact venture. Now, if you're an impact entrepreneur, you ask yourself the question, how can I use my technology to help the maximum number of people in the world? And you get a very surprising answer, Byron, because the answer is, well, what if I gave these spectacles to the 800 million illiterate adults in the world, people over the age of 15 who can't read? All of a sudden, I'm talking of a $1.1 billion market. Instead, there were 350 million market. So I think the reason we're going to see that this is as revolutionary as tech was in terms of delivering profits is that impact entrepreneurs are going to uncover new sets of opportunities as well. And if you improve both the risk and the return part of the equation, you have a good shot at doing that. And now you have great, eminent business school professors like Michael Porter saying that, you know, this is going to be the future. Shared value, as he calls it, is going to be the future. Now, it could be that some of us on this call who are particularly attracted to helping a particular group of people, whether it be prisoners who are released or the homeless or dropouts from school or whatever, are sometimes prepared to invest in companies that deliver a lower return because they like the impact that is being delivered. So it isn't philanthropy. It has a philanthropic objective in it, but it isn't philanthropy. And that's why I say in the book, I think it's just going to become good business. And I think businesses that can't evidence impact integrity through the measured impact, through their financial accounts, impact-weighted accounts, are basically not going to do well.
Well, what impact has the impact in another sense? What impact has the pandemic had? I mean, has this slowed things down at all? Is it? You and I had trouble connecting yesterday because you were at a G20 call or a G8 call for most of the day, which I assume involves a lot of different countries. Everyone has been affected by this pandemic. What is it, you know?
Well, it's a great question, Alan, and all of us will have views about it. But I think it's obvious we're going to emerge with greater inequality from this crisis. Some estimates are that 40% of those who lose their jobs won't be able to go back to the same job. If that happens, we're going to have high unemployment. We're going to need to reskill people. Governments are going to emerge with much greater debt than they had before, and they're going to have to cut their budgets. And if they do that, and you have a greater number of people who are suffering, then how do you do it if you don't bring private investment in? But to bring private investment in, you have to add, as Mr. Mallow, I think the name was saying from BlackRock, you have to add measurement to
you
it.
You can call him Matt. It's okay.
Matt is it? Yeah, sorry, I didn't hear it first. As Matt was saying, you're going to have to move in the direction of impact investing. If we have impact weighted accounts for companies within the next 2 years. And at the end of, before the end of this year, a project I'm involved with at Harvard Business School, led by a professor of accounting there, will publish the impact weighted accounts of 2,500 companies weighted for their environmental impact. And the next year, we will add product impact and employment impact. Now, if after 1929, we sat up and said, my God, how could we invest in companies when they don't use the same accounting principles and they don't have auditors? Let's create the SEC. I think after COVID-19, particularly as it's shaking our belief in a lot of our habits, we're going to wake up and say, my God, how have we been investing in companies and worrying only about the profit they create without creating their impact? And my hope is just as we brought in GAP, then we'll bring in GAPE now, generally accepted impact principles.
Patricia, someone named Samuel raised his hand, I saw.
Well, we've got a couple raised. First, Fred Hochberg, because he actually raised it before. And then Sam, and I know Jamie wants to ask a question too, but let me go to Fred Hochberg, our former Ex-Im Bank president and a terrific guy.
Thank you. And my hair is a mess because I haven't gotten a haircut since February.
me too. Me too, my friend.
Fred, did you notice me?
I did notice. I did shave today because I had a talk earlier today, but I noticed men left to their own devices are growing beards. So my question would be, you know, one of this has to do with just time horizon as I listen to this, because you know, if you have a longer time horizon, impact investing actually will make more money in the long run at some degree. What's an appropriate role of government? You know, that's a debate we seem to have in this country. We had a lot of investment under President Obama in renewable energy that then came to a screeching halt. When it comes to things like electric cars, without the incentives, it's hard to get enough volume that makes them really viable. So how do you look at that perspective, and how do you sort of scale that?
So it's a great question. The first thing we would like from government now, government's been helpful up until now in some countries, and I can explain, even in the US, there was $100 million budget allocation, which Paul Ryan put a lot of effort into getting for payments on impact bonds. You know, pay for success initiative. The Department, the Treasury, and the Department of Employment both changed regulations to allow trustees of pension funds and foundations to take into account non-financial dimensions of investment decisions into account, like social and environmental. So government's done a certain amount thus far. But the big thing we want government to do now is to mandate that every company has to publish impact-weighted accounts within 2 years, okay? And they may not be perfect. They weren't perfect in the early 30s financial accounts. We will refine them over time. But the minute you mandate that, companies are going to realize that Samuel Buffett's tide going out and exposing them naked is going to happen to them, and they'll begin to manage their impact. And then government does have to provide incentives along the way. So we reduced the capital gains tax rate in the late 70s, as Alan remembers, and he and I, as a result of that, Alan, if I remember rightly, the fund when you and I met 45 years ago that you were managing was $2.5 million. When we had the ERISA legislation come in, the next fund was $29 million a year after the legislation came in. So government can provide incentives for impact investing and of course, can pass regulations and taxation to punish those who are delivering negative impact. Today, what we really need is for government to grab this opportunity to bring investors and entrepreneurs and big businesses to its help in tackling our big social and environmental issues. Because if we don't do that, my speech of 2002 will be relevant today, but the scope of the curtain of fire is going to be extended virtually across the whole world.
Thank you. We're going to have Sam Waxel. Are you still there, Sam?
I am.
Okay. He's gotten shy. All righty.
No, I'm not shy. I haven't even gotten shy. So, Alan, Alan and I, by the way, hiked this morning. And he got me lost, and we wandered about for 2 hours.
So we knew we would make this event.
Yes, they were totally lost when I called this morning, and I was worried about whether we were going to have Alan on or not.
Right. Anyway, so but we're here. And Ronnie, you know, I love what you're doing. I always have. But there are issues in the world that are nuanced. And I'll give you an example, healthcare in the COVID crisis. And so, you know, we have a world right now where we've got many people trying to make vaccines, and some will. In fact, maybe 10 will. And then will come the question of how one charges for them. And in America, we can charge one thing. In Europe, we can charge another. And in developing countries, yet another. Not necessarily fairly, one. And two, not necessarily fairly, but how does social impact investing really play a game there? I mean, we have the Roches and Abbotts of the world making great diagnostics. We have Oxford and AstraZeneca and J&J probably making great vaccines. And we have a world that's difficult when it comes to healthcare.
Yeah. So if you take the example of tests, Sam, I don't know if you were on the line when I was talking of...
Yeah, I was.
Okay. So take the advantage of tests. One of the conditions for getting the order and getting the government guarantee for the investor money going in would be a 30% margin, for instance. That you can't extort, you can't profiteer from these, you know, from these situations. If you're gonna be there trying to help the world get over the COVID crisis, and you're gonna get government money for it and the government order for it, you're gonna have to stick to a 30% margin. And they have found ways, by the way, for, you know, the Ebola and so on, of having differential pricing. You know, without the product flowing back to markets where more is charged. But at the end of the day, the behavior of companies will be exposed through their impact-weighted accounts. And it may be that there is a governance line or that it is actually in the product. If you're delivering a product at a more reasonable price and you deliver the same treatment at a lower price, it'll count as positive impact for you and you'll get a boost to your impact weighted bottom line.
But Ron, when you have...
We got to move on. Sam, I see Stan Schumann has his hand raised.
Let's get Stan Schumann on the line.
Hi, Stan.
Stan doesn't know how to work a computer.
Let me do it on mute. Maybe.
Stanley, you know how to unmute yourself? Okay, well, he can't, I guess.
Here, let me try.
Stan? No. Well, he raised his hand, but he can't ask. Maybe you have to go on, Patricia, the next person.
How's that?
Yeah.
There we go.
Okay, sorry. So, Ronald, program-related investments have been part of the foundation world for a long time, but relatively small money. So once you bring in the necessity of the government guarantee, aren't you getting into the same issue of governmental policy lobbying against the people that are being pushed back at? For example, And how do you resolve that? There's a young woman in Australia by the name of Ronald King, who's an oncologist who's fighting tobacco-related investments around the world. She did a TED talk that was quite extraordinary, but the tobacco industry obviously is very resistant, even though there are 7 million deaths a year with respect to that. When you get into going up against the energy business, you have huge lobbies as well. Why won't this be part of the overall lobbying effort against those established companies that we're all trying to improve? And how do you deal with that?
So, very good question, Stan. I think governments are going to be under pressure to deal with the social inequality and with the climate crisis that is building up. Pressure just going to continue to increase after COVID. And it may well be that requiring companies to do certain things like stop polluting is more difficult than requiring them to publish impact weighted accounts and letting investors do the work of government in coercing them. As Matt was saying, you look today at how institutional investors and big family offices are changing their investment allocation in their portfolios in the direction of ESG because of pressure from their clients. And you can see that investors are pushing more and more money in this direction. So I think the trick for government may be to be an enabler rather than to rely on government to do things. Now, when you're talking of a COVID crisis and you want to bring $10 billion in with the cost of containment being $500 billion a month in the United States, doesn't sound like a big ask of government to guarantee innovation bonds. But I take your point. We're going to have to see how government handles the big lobbies. The most controversial part of my book, I think, isn't going to be the proposition that risk-return impact can deliver better returns, because you'll see examples in the book of very promising ventures and others that look perfectly capable of doing that. I think it's going to be the measurement of the impact of companies. I think you're going to get a very big pushback from Coca-Cola, which is compared with Pepsi-Cola. It's a third of the size from memory, and it pollutes 5 times as much. You're going to get pushback from companies. They're going to see this as a threat. But it behoves us all to push for that. It's what investors want. At the end of the day, investors are more powerful than companies.
Patricia?
Yeah, I was just seeing if Bernard wanted to make a comment or ask a question.
I see this as generally a philanthropic opportunity for people who are making investments in business, that's their business, but want to do some good with the money that they raise and use. And I think there are philanthropic people, investors everywhere, who will be attracted to an idea, but you have to put that idea before them. But I think it should be very successful and worthwhile.
Well, that's wonderful to hear. Thank you, Ben.
Yeah, we can't thank you enough, both you, Sir Ronald, and Alan, for this incredible conversation. It's actually very exciting. This is something that should, I would hope, would take off. So thank you so much for joining us at the Common Good today.
Patricia, I want to give one plug for Ronald's book. I get no royalties. I have no. I'm not even mentioned in it. Nor should I be. But I believe this will be a seminal book on this subject, and I think it will be used in college courses. I think it will be it will, you know, I can't tell you it's going to sell a million copies, but it will go into all the major institutions because this is a subject that's going to be here for the next 10 years and longer. So no, really, go to Amazon.
Really, no, it's great. It really expands the whole idea of social responsibility investing, and it's very, very exciting. And I hope you'll come back in person one of these days. And for all of you on the call today, thank you so much. We've got some interesting people coming up. We've got Richard Haas, the president of the Council on Foreign Relations, Anthony Scaramucci, the former White House communications director, with Robert Wolf, an investor, business leader, Senator Merkley from Oregon, former Congresswoman Jane Harman, who's at the Woodrow Wilson Center, and a lot of other interesting speakers. So please join us again. We really had an extraordinary group here for you, Sir Ronald. It's because of you and Alan. So thank you so much. And everybody, please come back.
Thank you so much, Alan. Wonderful to be on the stage together.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Bye-bye.
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 Bye-bye.